So, what is the difference between a forward-looking infrared and an infrared search and track? This is not a joke. Coming up. Welcome to Millennium 7 Star, the channel that helps you make sense of military history and military technology. I am sure you have heard these acronyms before. Forward-looking infrared, FLIR, or infrared search and track, IRST. At the end of the day, they both look like balls. They both hang or they're placed in the front of planes, but yeah, what's the difference? So the first thing to understand is that both use the same technologies. They both contain sensors which are sensitive to infrared radiation. Modern units use focal plane arrays, that is, sensors not dissimilar from the sensors that you have in your phone or in your camera. They normally don't use silicon, they use some exotic chemicals. Indium antimonide, mercury cadmium telluride, indium gallium arsenide, vanadium oxide. But the concept is exactly the same. The difference is in the use that is made of the two different systems. Normally, forward-looking infrared tend to be a bit bigger than infrared search and track because they have larger lenses, because they are used to basically take pictures. You have to think of forward-looking infrared as a big infrared sensitive camera, and like your camera can double to take pictures or filming a video. The flares are normally used for surveillance. In fact, you see them installed on maritime patrol planes or helicopters, even police helicopter, to be able to have a sensor to allow for surveillance even during the night. So they're normally mounted on a gimbal, they're normally stabilized and provide pictures and videos to the user. Military system can also integrate other sensors in the same turret. For example, you may have a visible light camera, you may have a laser telemeter or a laser designator mounted on the same turret. But this has nothing to do with the core technology of the forward-looking infrared, which is the infrared sensor. Like any serious infrared system, they obviously need cooling, and this is normally an engineering constraint because it means having some cryogenic liquid somehow available, or using some electric systems like the Peltier systems. The infrared search and track uses the same technology. Is a sensor mounted on a gimbal, but is used in a completely different way. The infrared search and track scans its field of view in search of infrared sources. Typically, if you're talking about a plane, point infrared sources. The information that in a specific direction there is this kind of source is then relayed back to the tactical presentation of the plane, and in modern planes it is integrated with the picture that is given by the radar. This is the main functioning mode of an infrared search and track. It replaces, up to a point, the radar to acquire the tactical situation in front of the plane. Modern infrared search and track are very, very capable. The most modern unit by many sources is considered to be the Skyward G, which is the infrared search and track, which is mounted on the Gripen EF. This unit is able to identify an infrared track, all aspects, in ideal condition up to 100 kilometers of distance, which starts being a distance that is not much different from a radar, with the obvious advantage that the system is completely passive. For example, the Skyward G is supposed to be able to identify a missile launch around 90 or 100 kilometer distance, providing a very early warning about missile launch and critically a very early warning about the launch of long-range weapons. The key component of the infrared search and track is the sensor, and every sensor has a different sensitivity on a different band of the infrared radiation depending on the material which is used. Some materials are very expensive, some others are difficult to manufacture in a large sensor, some others are difficult to produce, keeping the quality constant, but all of them have a specific use, either air-to-air or air-to-ground. The sensitivity of these materials may be from 2.5 micrometers to 12 micrometers. Indium antimonide, mercury cadmium telluride, indium gallium arsenide, vanadium oxide. The longest is the wavelength, the higher is the penetration in clouds, dust and similar. The flip side is that the longer the wavelength, the less sharp, let's say, is the picture that is used to identify the target. With an evolution that conceptually is not much different to what happened with the AESA radars, modern infrared search and track scan a large portion of the field of view with their focal plane arrays and use image recognition techniques to identify the targets at long distance. Actually, the target is no more than a blip, but we know that the characteristics of the blip can tell us quite a lot about the kind of eventual menace the blip is. As a secondary capacity, these systems are also able to provide pictures to the pilot, and this is very important because the rules of engagement normally, in most situations, including all-out wars, suppose that before firing, the target is identified with no incertitude as being hostile. The safest way of identifying a target is visually. So, if we are providing the pilot the possibility to extend the range of visual identification, yes, we are doing a great service. It is a big advantage. One issue of the infrared search and track is that they can't provide the distance of the target. Modern systems actually integrate within the same gimbal, within the same mechanic assembly of the infrared search and track, they also integrate a laser telemeter. So a quick laser illumination can provide the distance at the price of not being passive anymore. I mean, in the modern battle space that is so crowded with electromagnetic emissions and with electromagnetic systems that interact with each other, having a complete passive system is a big advantage. Additionally, with the current level of technology, there's no way that infrared emissions could be suppressed without really heavy penalties in terms of performance. If any, the tendency is to have engines that work at higher and higher temperatures because they improve the efficiency. So yes, the infrared search and track is probably going to become an essential piece of equipment very, very early. So I hope you have enjoyed this video. If you want to learn more about air-to-air missiles, air-to-air combat and the like, please click on the videos beside me. For the moment being, thank you for watching and goodbye.